Vladimir Putin has had a stranglehold on Russian leadership for more than 20 years, but for the authoritarian president, there is blood in the water. Questions now being asked about his future after the abrupt end of a revolution that withered away as quickly as it gained momentum.
Europe correspondent Brett McLeod is across it all. Brett, the world watching very closely to see what Putin does next.
Yes, and a strong man's leadership does require a projection of strength. But 24 hours on, we've just had silence from Vladimir Putin ever since that uprising was quelled. We've seen nor heard of him, and that has led to much speculation about what's going on in the Kremlin. Is he even there? Has he gone to St. Petersburg? Is he somewhere else? Also, questions too about the man who led that uprising, Yevgeny Prigozhin, the head of the Wagner military group, who promised he would go to Belarus and call off that attempted rebellion. But again, we haven't seen or heard from him. Those troops that he led have started withdrawing from key military positions, but whether they'll rejoin the regular Russian military or not, well, that remains to be seen too. Watching and waiting, the United States, UK and many other countries. US Secretary of State Antony Blinken taking a very careful line, not showing America interfering in Russia's internal problems, making some fine points about cracks showing in their leadership.
So I think this is clearly, we see cracks emerging. Where they go, if anywhere, when they get there, very hard to say. I don't want to speculate on it, but I don't think we've seen the final act.
And also talking about this has been the US President Joe Biden and his counterpart in Ukraine, Volodymyr Zelensky, who tweeted out that the world must put pressure on Russia until international order is restored.
Thank you, Brett.
Well, for the first time in 23 years, cracks are beginning to show in Vladimir Putin's leadership. The Russian president faced a major challenge over the weekend, his private mercenaries staging an armed rebellion, seizing two major Russian cities. The Wagner Group's march on Moscow was only called off after the mercenaries forced Putin into agreeing to an amnesty deal. Sam Kiley, CNN's senior international correspondent and former Pentagon operative and White House advisor Tony Schaefer, join me now. Thank you both for your time. Sam, I'll start with you. Is this the beginning of the end for Vladimir Putin?
Well, that's certainly what Putin's enemies would like to think. It's definitely what the Ukrainians would love to see. But I don't think that it would be wise to see this as anything other than extremely dangerous for the Russian leader, but at the same time, not the sort of thing that he can't weather. Remember that this is a completely authoritarian country. It is a country that has been full square behind him insofar as there are legitimate democratic processes or even opinion polls. Broadly speaking, there is support, significant support for Vladimir Putin and indeed his campaign in Ukraine. So in that context, I don't think we should write him off anytime soon at all. In terms of the campaign inside Ukraine, I think this has been extremely damaging for the Russians, not least because Prigozhin, the leader of the Wagner group that has been, in his words, in the center of the meat grinder, particularly of Bakhmut, withdrew from that bloody city a couple of weeks ago. And then in as part of launching this campaign to try to unseat certainly unseat the military leadership within Russia, said very openly and publicly that Putin's reasons for invading Ukraine were not valid. After being there on the front line, he said that it wasn't to do with protecting Russia's borders against NATO encroachment and so on. Now, that is absolutely central to the justification for Vladimir Putin's invasion of that country. And that is something that longer term he's going to have to deal with. And that could very much undermine the campaign, if not his own leadership.
Well, it blows it all up, doesn't it, Sam, to an extent? I mean, this is more than just bruising Putin's ego here.
Oh, it's a lot more bruising than that. It is very disastrous in terms of the military structures, and it could have been much more disastrous in terms of the political future. But the fact is that somehow Lukashenko in neighbouring Belarus was able to persuade Prigozhin to accept a deal that he would turn his troops round 125 miles, 200 kilometres away from Moscow, get them back into what they call field camps, in other words, their rear bases, down towards Rostov-on-Don and elsewhere in return for amnesty, effectively, and for Prigozhin to go and live in exile in Belarus. It's very unclear as to how this is going to pan out. There are 25,000 men in Wagner who will be, at the very least, disgruntled and distrusted. So how they are treated next will also be very important for the future of the Russian stability and indeed the military stability inside Ukraine.
No, a lot to keep an eye on. Tony, let's bring in you now. How powerful are these mercenaries? I mean, obviously they've been doing Russia's bidding in Ukraine. They've also been active in Syria. They do flex a lot of muscle.
Right. They do. And they actually provide direct support to the Chinese. Globally, the Chinese actually use Wagner as their kind of personal security detail in many of their missions. So this is no small issue. As a matter of fact, one of the rumors here in the United States is that the Chinese had a role in pushing Prigozhin into exile. So this is no small issue. And Wagner, for better or for worse, is a major component of Russian military strength.
And I guess, Tony, the concern now becomes, what comes next, I guess. How do you see, interesting, those rumors you just mentioned there. What does come after this?
Right. Well, look, I think Putin said something to pay attention to. During his speech on Sunday morning, he actually referenced the 1917 revolution. Now, there was two revolutions in 1917. There was the one where they got rid of the Tsar, and the October Revolution where the Soviets came in. So he was referring to that regarding the path forward, what to expect. And one of the grand ironies of the recent past of Russia is that when you had a similar coup, a coup attempt against, I think it was 1991, 1992, where Mikhail Gorbachev survived the coup, but then was completely hobbled from there forward. So again, I agree, this may not be the end for Putin, but this may be the beginning of the of his decline into nothingness.
We think the attempted uprising in Russia is expected to increase risks for investors when the markets reopen today.
To discuss, let's bring in John Keogh, economics editor of the Financial Review. Good morning, Johnny. How will the markets react to the insane events in Russia recently?
Yes, good morning, Alex and Sarah. Look, we're going to see a bumpy start to the week on the stock market, that's for sure. Look, on Friday night into the weekend, we saw the Russian ruble sell off very heavily. And now all eyes this morning are going to be on what happens to the oil price, because Russia is such a big producer of energy. It's not only that uprising by the Wagner Group, which seems to have settled down somewhat, but what this might mean for the ongoing war in Ukraine. There's a lot of uncertainty around that. ASX futures pricing pointing to a fall when the market opens this morning.
John, a couple of crucial economic reports out this week that the Reserve Bank will be watching very, very closely.
Absolutely, Alex. On Wednesday, we're going to get inflation data, and the Reserve Bank will be really hoping that it moderates from the 6.8%, which was too high in April. They want to see that falling to 6% or below. We're also going to get retail sales out on Thursday. Now, big box retailers have been telling investors the last couple of weeks that there's been a really big pullback in consumer discretionary spending. People just not spending as much because of those rate rises, but also trading down to cheaper items and buying more home label products too, trying to get more value for their money.
Okay. We wait with bated breath. John, thank you.
Well, it was a hectic 36 hours for Russian President Vladimir Putin as he faced the greatest challenge to his leadership in decades, culminating in the leader of the rebellious Wagner Group agreeing to exile in Belarus. Joining us to discuss today's headlines is Tasmanian Senator Jackie Lambie and commentator Scott Emerson. Thank you both for your time this Monday morning. Jackie, what do you think this means for Putin's presidency?
It's not so much Putin's presidency right now, but right now they've shown a really weak area, and at all times that we should be backing in Ukraine and giving them every piece of equipment we possibly can. Now is the time to do it while they're in chaos. I mean, ourselves, we've promised, they need those 90 Hawkeyes that they've asked for, the bush rangers, and a crap load of more missiles. And if I can say anything out there to our Western counterparts who are involved with this and backing Ukraine, they've got to have air support, and they need that today. We've got to supply some sort of air support. Mm. Otherwise, if you keep that tap dripping, Sarah, we will end up there with boots on the ground. We've got to go in there strong and hard and fast now. Stop the drip from tapping. I ask that from my Western allies and give them everything we possibly can and back Ukraine to the hilt today.
That would be music to the ears of Ukrainians, that's for sure, because this is, as you said, Jackie, probably highlighting the weakness that we've seen from the strongman up until now. Scott, with his mercenaries offside, is this going to tip the scales in Ukraine's favour, do you think?
Oh, we'd have to think so, Sarah. You know, it's extraordinary to think about where we were 2 years ago. Putin was unsurmountable. He was locked in for leadership. And now we're seeing cracks in his regime. Just as what a disaster the invasion of Ukraine has been. And you'd have to think to the troops there fighting for Russia at the moment, all they heard is from a former Putin ally who turned against him saying, you've been conned. This wasn't something we should have been fighting. And that surely must start to undermine his leadership.